Bajaj Consumer Care's promoters sold nearly 22% of their stake in the company on Tuesday to free up the pledged shares. Mutual fund houses stepped in, with the likes of ICICI Prudential and HDFC AMC picking up stake, to name two of the many. The Bajaj family now hold 38% stake in the company, but with the pledged share overhang now gone, does it remove that technical overhang on the company? And how is the fundamentals of the business anyways looking like? Let's expand on that further with Kushagra and Bajaj, the non-executive chairman of the company, joins us right now on the show. Good having you, Mr. Bajaj. Thanks for joining in. Would you say that with this action that you've done, any technical overhangs about pledged shares getting sold out in the market would now be permanently erased? What is the structure now looking like? What's the quantum of pledges, if any, that are there currently? When do they get released? What's the further game plan?
Well, this was done as a clean-out trade. Post the stake sale, there is no more personal debt at the promoter level. There's no more debt at the promoter level. So how the markets will react on a technical level, I am not the expert to say. I can only clarify, which I have already done earlier through a press release, that post this stake sale, the promoters do not have any debt at a personal level, and there will be no more stake sale going forward.
Okay, and is the entire pledge shares now cleaned up, Mr. Bajaj?
Yes, absolutely. Post the stake sale and post the debt repayment, the entire pledge is gone.
So now, which is what I was saying. So now, at least there are no technical factors hampering this, because we've seen in a number of cases how the stock prices tend to react when some of the promoter equity might come in into the market as well. Can you tell us how is business looking, Mr. Bajaj? There were reasons specifically to the sell side, as a result of which, despite showing the kind of growth that you've shown, the valuations were not high. Now that all of that baggage is behind, can you tell us a bit about the business first?
So I think, like any other FMCG company, we are seeing very tepid growth, 2, 3, 4% kind of growth. Surprisingly, after 20 quarters, for the first quarter, September quarter ending, we saw rural growth lower than urban growth. In fact, rural grew at a negative level and urban grew at a very low single digit. So this is very unusual. We have really, I think this is the slowing of the economy, and the growth rate, slow growth rate in volume and value uptick, is worse than what it was post demonetization or even GST. I think it'll be at least 4 to 6 quarters that it will remain like this. I don't see any great upside where you can get double digit growth in the immediate to short term. But margins are still good. We have a strategy called Project Vistar, which we have adopted since April of this year, to try and see how we can double our market share in the hair oil category from 10% to 20% over the next 5-6 years. And we are working towards that. We have done the implementation of that in one state as a test case, and the results have been very, very good. We are now, from 1st of November, launching that in another state, the same strategy, and then slowly take it pan India. So I think the sector is slowing, but we are going to be over-investing in our brand, in our category, to try and gain market share. And even if that means that margins would be reduced by a couple of percentage points, so be it. Because we believe that the Indian economy is resilient and strong, and the economy will bounce back, and you will start getting growth. Even just baseline growth will go up substantially over a period of time. And at that time, if you have higher market share on a larger base, it will reflect very healthily in the numbers.
Mm-hmm. So you would reckon, Mr. Bajaj, that even though there might be near-term pain, and frankly, it's anybody's guess as to when it comes up, thanks for being so candid, of course, about what the near-term growth could look like, you reckon that the long-term growth trajectory of the company is solid, and therefore you may not want to, I presume, on your own discretion basis, reduce your stake any further? You'd be happy with the current stake?
I don't think we'd be happy with the current stake. We would actually, through the creeping acquisition route, as per SEBI norms, increase our stake over a period of time and take it to at least 51%, if not higher. So that's a given. As and when the liquidity is there, and as and when whatever the laws prevail, we will, over a period of time, take the shareholding back to 50-51% at least, if not higher. So that's one. And second, as I said, the hair oil category is the second largest personal care category. It's a $2 billion category, roughly. Very limited competition in just three or four major players. We are the second largest in the category. And our intent is just to double market share, even in a slowing economy. And we will over-invest. I think, you know, fundamentals of economics is that you should always invest when the economy is down, so that whenever the economy bounces back up, you see disproportionate returns on your investment. And most people don't do that, but that's what we plan to do. So that's what I said, even if we over-invest in our brand and in our category, if that means our margins go down a couple of percentage points in the short to medium term, we are okay with it. But we are looking at it from a 5, 10, 15 year perspective and not just a 2 to 3 year perspective.
I'm glad you said that, because there were a few, not really reports, but conversations that come up speaking about whether or not the Kushagra Nayan Bajaj Group might, if they get a lucrative offer, go out and sell a majority strategic stake in Bajaj Consumer. I'm guessing from your answer that that is off the table.
It was never on the table for it to go off the table.
Okay, fine. Let me rephrase my question.
I think those were rumors. So the so they were never, there was never a discussion at my level or anybody in the company or the group level on that. The intent was never to sell the business. It never was, it never is, and never will be. It's been in the family for about 130, 40 years. We can hope that it will remain in the family for the next 130, 40 years. As I said, the intent is to take promoter shareholding back to 51%, if not higher, over a period of time, as per the rules of the country.
Now, Touchwood, and I certainly hope, Mr. Bajaj, that it remains that way. You're doing a fine job at that company. I think the conversations probably only come up because, as you said, the economy is not going through the best of times. And somehow at times, if the other group businesses may or may not be doing as well, then question marks arise about almost all the businesses of a particular group. And allow me to ask you about that then. For not just your company alone, but the spaces that you are in at large are also under a bit of distress. It's not just restricted to your company, be it Power, be it Sugar, be it the other businesses. Would there be any, pardon my language, repercussions of that onto the Bajaj Consumer portfolio that you have, because that's a golden goose of sorts that you have?
In fact, the the DRHP has been approved for the Power list, Power IPO. So the numbers are there in the DRHP for everybody to see. The Power business is extremely profitable and doing well. So there will be no repercussions of that. On the contrary, there can be only positive repercussions as and when the IPO, the Power business goes, happens. So there's no repercussion on that. On the Sugar side, there's no capex going forward. The debt has been taken care of, through a restructuring 4 years ago, and the business is doing fine. The sugar cycle is in a sweet spot at this point in time, although the business always remains politically sensitive. But there is no overhang of any business risk from one business to the other. Firstly, they are completely ring-fenced. Second, each of them are extremely profitable at this point of time, even in a slowing economy. On a standalone basis. So I don't see any risk going forward. I think the rumors may have been more because of the debt at a promoter level, which now has been completely resolved. And we solved our problem, whatever we had, and we're just looking forward for a successful IPO of the Power business as and when that happens.
Okay, so fine. I mean, you've given us clarity, enough clarity on most things, Mr. Bajaj. Just one final question then. You mentioned that the DRHP has been filed and you're looking to list this. Any timelines? And the reason, again, I'm not asking for a specific month or something, but because of the general stress that the Power business seems to be in, wherein one or two players might be doing okay. The stock prices aren't, by the way, even of those companies which are doing okay. But by and large, the space is not finding enough takers. Would you look to list this within a particular time frame, or is this subject to when you get the favorable valuations?
I think we are not desperate sellers. We are keen, but not desperate. So if there's enough demand at a particular price, I guess that's when we'll do it. At this point of time, we've just got SEBI permission to do the IPO. It's valid for a year, as you know, and we will see the right time to do it and at the right valuation. It's been a long time since an IPO has happened in the power business. It's been almost 11 and a half years, if I recollect. It's been almost 11 and a half years. And there has not been any equity raising, any meaningful equity raising from any of the private power producers over the last 11 and a half years. So I think this is a core sector of the economy, electricity. It's capital intensive. Without equity raising, it is very difficult to sustain growth. So I think we need to make sure that the valuation is right so that investors make money and the whole equity raising for the entire sector gets kick-started through the our IPO process. So it's a very onerous task that we have. Just not that we do our IPO, but if we can kick-start the whole confidence in the power sector for equity investors so that even others in the sector can start raising equity, that's what we're looking for.
So could happen
so
in
we
the...
we need to leave enough money on the table in terms of equity value.
Okay.
Sorry.
No, sorry, I interrupted you. Please go on.
No, I'm almost done. You can ask.
No, I was just wondering. So then you're saying that you need to leave enough equity on the table for investors to get excited as well. But having said that, I mean, therefore, I presume from your answer that it's not a definitive that it'll happen in the next 3 months. It could take maybe 6 months as well, or could longer too, depending on market conditions and the valuations.
Neeraj, you know, I'm not the expert of the markets. As they say, markets are the ultimate, they know exactly when and what will happen. It's very difficult to say whether it will happen tomorrow or in 2 months' time or 6 months' time. All we can say is that we have got permission and we'll wait for the right timing.
Okay, one final question, Mr. Bajaj, because we don't get you that often. You mentioned that sugar seems to be in a sweet spot. I've tracked this space now for close to 14, 15 years. There never seems to be a change as strong as right now, wherein there is a bit of predictability to earnings. Could you dwell a bit upon how do you foresee the next 3-4 years? And if you believe that this time around, it really is different compared to the past?
I don't believe it's different from the past, to be very honest with you. Because it has been, and it will always remain an extremely politically sensitive industry. Today, things can turn in a day in the sugar industry. If they increase cane prices disproportionately, the entire earnings can disappear overnight. So I don't think, yes, the ethanol program has been kick-started by the government. They've allowed converting sugarcane juice to ethanol also. So these are big positive steps, but the fundamental is that 80-85% of revenues come from sugar for any company in India, and if the raw material prices are disproportionately increased and it's not allowed to be passed on to consumers in terms of effective increase in sugar prices, which normally the government tries to in a manner of speaking cap, then things can go downwards very quickly. So I don't think anything fundamentally in the sector has changed, to be very honest with you.
Okay, well, it's candid enough and really appreciate that. Thanks so much, Mr. Bajaj, for joining in today and speaking to us at Bloomberg Quint. And all the best with your plans.
Thank you for having me. Thank you very much.
Something's being laid out by the non-executive chairman on the table, not looking to dilute any further stake. In fact, saying that they would want to, through the creeping acquisition route, take the stake in Bajaj Consumer Care northwards of 51%, but don't see any immediate growth over the next maybe 4 to 6 quarters in that business. The other business, again, power and sugar, they don't believe that there is too much of stress. And the power IPO, subject to the market conditions, but they have gotten the permissions to raise the money as and when they deem fit. Thanks for joining into this broadcast from Bloomberg Quint.